Let's read together 2 Samuel chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. My heart rejoices in the Lord. The Lord has made me strong. Now I have an answer for my enemies. I rejoice because you rescued me. No one is holy like the Lord. There is no one beside you. There is no rock like our God.
Tears to dim the eye.
beautiful morning. And we're gathered together on this beautiful Sunday. And one of the things that we are doing this morning is we're honoring our mothers. I'm going to say happy Mother's Day to you. But our focus mainly is not on our Mother's Day, on mothers, but on our Lord. So let's go to Him in prayer. Father God, we thank You for today. Our hearts are full of praise because we are here today to glorify Your name. But Father, we're also here to acknowledge a blessing that You put into our lives, our mothers, who have done so much over the years for us. And Father, we just pray that with Your blessing, we'll be able to honor moms today so that we, in honoring them, we can give glory and praise to You. Father, we thank You and we praise You. In Your Son's holy and precious name. Amen. As I said, happy Mother's Day to each of the mothers that are here this morning. We are looking forward to be able to honor you with a variety of different ways this morning. But first of all, to acknowledge that you are the gift that every person has from God. A couple other announcements we have this morning. Just a quick reminder that our Bible study on God's Word, the power to shape our lives, is continuing. We'll be meeting at 7 p.m. here at the church. For those of you who aren't in the area, we would love to have you join us at 7 p.m. Pacific time via Zoom. You can give the church a call or drop me an email this week, or even post an acknowledgement in the messages on the YouTube channel for this video, and we will do what we can to make sure you can join us on Wednesdays. Our men's group meets here at the church on Tuesday mornings at 9:30 a.m. And just so you know, that invitation to join us on Zoom is with that also. And we've been able to, because of those who don't live in the area wanting to continue joining us, are doing so. We're gathering for a time of Bible discussion and prayer on Tuesday mornings. Our sewer replacement fund. Our goal was $9,363. We have received $3,628 up until last Sunday. We still have $5,771, and according to the pledges that we have into this date, we should have the estimate payoff will be in March of next year. But it looks like it's a possibility it may be paid off even quicker than that. So we have that looking forward on us. Our women's group is continuing their diaper drive for just a couple more weeks. The last Sunday of this month is the last Sunday for the diaper drive. So we'll continue to hope to be able to see more and more piled up. They are going for the Caring for Women ministry here in town to meet the needs of young ladies and families in our area. Tomorrow evening at 6:30 p.m. here at the church is our cabinet meeting. So just a reminder that our cabinet meetings are open to members and regular attenders of our church. So we would look forward to that. We do have to make some final decisions regarding our congregational meeting, which we'll talk about more about next week, that's coming up. This Saturday is Red Suspenders Day. We'd like to have you come down to see what's going on, to help out. We are going to be showing some of Bruce Anderson's paintings, and he has requested that we set up a silent auction for those paintings, so you can possibly be able to receive one of those paintings if your bid for that on that side auction is the highest bid for that painting. We're also having our open house here, and we're going to be providing an eating area for people through the food that because of the food trucks. And so that's what we have going on this week. So pray for us this week. Mark your calendars to join us this Saturday. Volunteers on Saturday morning, if you can be here at 7:30 in the morning, we'll be grateful to be able to get things set up in time for everything. This evening is not going to be our evening worship because of Mother's Day. We're wanting you to bless your moms this evening by doing something special for them. But next week we'll be actually starting. We were going to start last week, but some things came up. Starting the Forgotten God. And so we got that coming up next week. We do have a couple of birthdays we want to acknowledge. Flo's birthday is today, so we want to say happy birthday to Flo. Mike Spencer's birthday is on Wednesday, and Emily Tamez's birthday is on Saturday. And we have this song just for you.
It's your birthday and we celebrate the day you were born, the light that God gave. Yeah, it's your birthday and we are all here, thanking the Lord for giving you one more year.
The voice of God is calling to the Lord. Morning. Mother's Day has a fascinating history. While versions of the holiday existed in the 19th century, the modern Mother's Day originated in 1908 when Anna Jarvis held a memorial for her mother at her church in Grafton, West Virginia. Jarvis's mother, Anne, was a Civil War peace activist who tirelessly nursed Northern and Southern soldiers. Anna passionately called for America to designate a national holiday that remembered her mom and all mothers. In 1914, President Woodrow Wilson finally signed a national proclamation for Mother's Day. Unfortunately, commercialization of the holiday by greeting card companies, florists, and candy makers quickly followed. Anna Jarvis resented this crass commercialization and publicly protested against those who tried to profit. In the end, Anna worked to rescind the holiday. This is how the current Mother's Day came to be, but the celebration of moms and motherhood is ancient. Both the Greeks and Romans held festivals to mother goddesses. In the 16th century, European believers, both Catholic and Protestant, created Mothering Sunday during Lent for parishioners to recognize the mother church of their baptism. Mothers were also honored with presents and flowers. Moms are also honored in the scriptures. Adam named his mate Eve, which comes from a Hebrew word that means life. In Proverbs 23:22, we're told to not despise your mother when she is old. Jesus respected his mother. While hanging on the cross, Jesus instructed John to care for Mary as though she were his own mother. The epistle writers challenged believers to obey their mothers. Moms matter, and it's important we show honor and respect for them. We mustn't forget why we commemorate Mother's Day. It's the same with the Lord's Supper. In 1 Corinthians 11, Paul cautioned the Corinthians against consuming the bread and drinking the cup in an unworthy, forgetful manner. To do so, he taught, was dishonorable and disrespectful. sinning against the body and blood of Jesus. Today, as we celebrate our mothers, let us honor Jesus with even higher reverence. After all, we are born by blood into this life through our earthly moms, but we're reborn by the Spirit into eternal life through Jesus Christ. This meal is how we remember him. Let us remember and honor. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the chance to gather together in your house and worship you. We thank you for giving us our mothers and all the blessings that they bestow upon us, their teaching, unconditional love, and the gift of life. And we thank you for your Son, Christ Jesus, who offers us an eternal version of these same gifts. Help us to live out our lives, always remembering and honoring both our mothers and you, our Heavenly Father. We pray a blessing over these emblems we're about to partake in. In your holy and precious name, amen. Would you please repeat with me the good confession? I believe with all my heart that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Before we take up our offering, let's have a word of prayer. Lord, we are so blessed by you. We are blessed with this day, blessed with this chance to gather in your house, and blessed to be able to give back to you. We pray that the offerings collected today be used for your glory, to bless others, and to further your kingdom. We pray this in your holy and precious name. Amen.
As we come to our time of prayers and praises, we, like we've been talking about with each other, about the importance of moms, we want to take time to say thank you to the Lord for our mothers and our grandmothers and what they've done in our lives, especially those mothers and grandmothers that have helped point us to a relationship with Jesus Christ. And also I'll praise the adult Christian retreat that June Brown and I had the privilege to attend this last week. Was just a wonderful time. The speakers were great. The worship was great. The food was great. and we had a great time. A couple of prayers, as some of you have heard already, Sharon Lofmiller is in the hospital. She fell last week, and after a day or so after she fell, and she said she was doing good. There was no marks or anything. She just wasn't doing right, and her son John called the ambulance to come and get her, and she went down to the hospital on Thursday evening. And so she's now up at Inlow. They're still trying to figure out what was going on. And then June Brown came back from the Christian retreat and wasn't really feeling very well. And Bonnie took her down to the hospital. And as of last I heard, she's up at Inlow also. They're not sure exactly. They're looking at possibilities with her heart. And so we want to keep Sharon and June Brown, who are in the hospital right now. And also, Bruce Anderson is having surgery, and if I remember correctly, it's for his spine. And so they're going to be doing that to help straighten his spine up some this Thursday morning. That's the 17th. And also, we want to been asked to pray for Sally Eaton. She has not been feeling well the last week or so, and so we want to be able to lift her up. And also this Saturday, as we mentioned earlier, is Red Suspenders Day, and we have an active part in that. And pray this week, not just this morning, this week, that our being seen on Saturday will be a glory to our God. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you for this morning, the opportunity to gather together. We thank you for the blessings you've poured on our lives. I've just have a couple on our sheet here this morning, Lord, but you know that there are more blessings than that, and we are grateful to you for them. Father, we thank you for the moms and grandmothers you've put in our lives, especially those that have helped point us to you. And Father, we're grateful for the blessings that you show us and have given us through them. And Father, I personally thank you for the time up at Heavenly Hills Christian Camp. And the retreat there and all that went on, the people and the speakers and the worship and everything, Father. We thank you for what you've done in people's lives. But Father, with that in mind, our heart goes out to Sharon and June, both in the hospital, both for different reasons, but both at the same time. And Father, I ask that you be with the doctors and the medical staff that are there. Give them the wisdom to be able to deal with what they have, but above that, Father, we ask for your healing hand on them. And Father, we pray that you'll bring them to health and bring them home, but we pray in such a way that we understand that what we ask may not be what you see as best, and our ultimate desire is what is best in your eyes, not necessarily ours. And Father, the same thing with Bruce. I ask that you be with the doctors and those involved in the surgery and give them the wisdom and guidance. At the same time, we ask your healing hand upon him. At the same time, we understand that our asking is based from our limited view, and we ultimately want what you see as what is best. And Father, we say thank you now for what is going to happen. Father, we continue to lift Sally up to you. We just pray that that which is keeping her down will not hinder her desire and ability to reach out and touch the lives of those around her that she knows. And Father, we lift our church up, our congregation, as this Saturday we face the Red Suspenders opportunity. And Father, help us to step up where you need us to be. We ask your, not just our blessings on what we're doing, but your guidance. And we just pray that ultimately your love will be seen by us. And Father, I just pray that you will speak through me and allow your words to shine as I share from your word, so that together we may give you the glory, you the honor. Father, this we pray in your son's holy and precious name. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning is found in Matthew chapter 20, verses 20 to 23. Then the mother of the sons of Zebedee came to him with her sons, bowing down and making a request of him, and he said to her, "What do you wish?"
She said to him, command that your that in your kingdom these two sons of mine may sit, one on your right and one on your left. But Jesus answered and said, you do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup I'm about to drink? They said to him, we are able. He said to them, my cup you shall drink. But to sit on my right and on my left is not mine to give, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared by my Father. As we look towards Mother's Day this morning, I wanted to step out of our trip through Romans and just focus on mothers, and specifically this morning, a mother's love. There's nothing stronger and more powerful than the love of a mother we see in today's lives today. Someone wrote, Mother's Day is traditionally the day when children give something back to their mothers for all the spit they produce to wash dirty faces, all the old gum they held in their hands, all the noses they've wiped, and all the bloody knees they made well with their kisses. This is the day mothers are rewarded for washing sheets in the middle of the night, driving kids to school when they miss the bus, and enduring all those football and soccer games in the rain. It's a day of appreciation for making your children finish something they said they couldn't do, not believing them when they said, I hate you, and sharing their good times and their bad. What are mothers? Well, mothers are teachers. Mothers are disciplinarians. Mothers are cleaning ladies. Some mothers are gardeners and mowers of lawns. Mothers are nurses and doctors and psychologists and counselors and chauffeurs and coaches. Mothers are developers of personalities, molders of vocabularies, and shapers of attitudes. Mothers are soft voices saying, I love you. And mothers are a link to God, a child's first impression of God's love. Mothers are all these things and much more. One of the most quoted columns by Irma Bombeck tells of God in the act of creating mothers. She wrote this, on the day God created mothers, he had already worked long overtime. An angel said to him, Lord, are you sure are spending a lot of time on this one? The Lord turned and said, have you read the specs on this model? She is supposed to be completely washable, but not plastic. She has to have 180 moving parts, all of them replaceable. She has to have a kiss that will heal everything from a broken leg to a broken heart. She has to have a lap that will disappear whenever she stands up. She has to be able to function on black coffee and leftovers. And she is supposed to have 6 pairs of hands. 6 pairs of hands, the angel said. That's impossible. Well, it's not the 6 pair of hands that bother me, said the Lord. It's the 3 pairs of eyes. She is supposed to have 1 pair that sees through closed doors, so whenever she says, what are you kids doing in there? She already knows what they are doing. She has another pair in the back of her head to see all the things she's not supposed to see, but must see. And she has 1 pair right in front that can look at a child who goofed and communicate love and understanding without saying a word. That's too much, said the angel. You can't put that much in one model. Why don't you rest a while and resume while you're creating tomorrow? No, I can't, said the Lord. I'm close to creating someone very much like myself. I've already came up with a model who can heal herself when she's sick, who can feed a family of 6 with 1 pound of hamburger, and who can persuade a 9-year-old to take a shower. Then the angel looked at the model of motherhood and said, looked at the model of motherhood a little more closely and said, she's too soft. Oh, but she is tough, said the Lord. You'd be surprised how much this mother can do. Can she think? Asked the angel. Not only can she think, said the Lord, but she can reason and compromise and persuade. Then the angel reached over and touched her cheek. This one has a leak, he said. I told you that you shouldn't put that much into one model. That's not a leak, said the Lord. That's a tear. What's a tear for? Asked the angel. Well, it's for joy, for sadness, for sorrow, for disappointment, for pride. You're a genius, said the angel. And then the Lord said, oh, but I didn't put it there. Maybe with all this in mind, we can better understand Mrs. Zebedee, the mother of the apostles James and John. I know I read it earlier, but let me read it again so you can listen to the words with all that I had just said in your mind. So again, Matthew 20, verses 20 to 23. Then the mother of the sons of Zebedee came up to him with her sons, and kneeling before him, she asked him for something. And he said to her, what do you want? She said to him, say that these two sons of mine are to sit, one on your right hand and one on your left in your kingdom. Jesus answered, do you not know what you are asking? Are you able to drink the cup that I'm to drink? They said to him, we are able. He said to them, you will drink my cup, but to sit at my right hand and at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those whom it has been prepared by my Father. Mrs. Zebedee, by the way, was aware of the teachings of Jesus and about his kingdom. She was also very aware of the fact that her sons, James and John, were close to him. They were two of the three inner circle of Peter, James, and John. So she was certain that when the Lord formed his kingdom, that they would have positions of responsibility and authority. But in the first part of this chapter, chapter 20, the first 16 verses, Jesus tells a story that might have disturbed her. He said, for the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire men to work in his vineyard. And from there, Jesus goes on to say that they agreed upon a fair day's wage and started working. And then towards evening he went out and found some more and they started working. And yet when the landlord paid them off, at the end of the day, they all received the same wage. This might have caused Mrs. Zebedee to wonder, will my sons really have positions of authority in the Lord's new kingdom? So when the opportunity presented itself, she came to Jesus with James and John in tow, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee came to him with her sons, and kneeling before him, she asked him for something. And he said to her, what do you want? Now let me stop there for a moment. This is so real to me. How many times has someone come to you and asked, can I ask you something? Or will you do me a favor? That's kind of what Mrs. Zebedee is doing here. She said to him, say that these two sons of mine are to sit, one on your right hand and one on your left in your kingdom. We might well criticize Mrs. Zebedee for being so bold. But since today is Mother's Day, maybe we ought to think for a few moments about some positive things concerning Mrs. Zebedee. We also need to recognize that when she came to Jesus, while Jesus did not grant her request, he didn't deny it either. He simply reminded her, as well as James and John, of the cost of being seated on the right or left, and told them that it is a father who determines who will be seated in those seats of honor. So now, what are some good things about Mrs. Zebedee? Well, first of all, she wanted her sons to be part of Jesus' kingdom. She came to the Lord asking that her sons might be part of his kingdom. I can't think of a task more important for a mother than that. To seek and to ensure that your children are part of the kingdom of God. I know many mothers pray. Sometimes they pray out of necessity. Sometimes they pray because being a mother is not easy. It's extremely difficult. James Dobson tells about a time when he came home when his son Ryan was a small baby. It had been a terrible day for his wife, and Ryan had been sick and cried all day. Once, as she was changing his diapers, the telephone rang, and Shirley reached over to answer it before fastening up his diaper. Just then, Ryan had another attack of diarrhea. She cleaned up the mess, put him in clean, sweet-smelling clothes, and then took him into the living room to feed him. And as she was burping him, he threw up all over himself and her and the couch, too. Dobson wrote this, "When I came home, I can smell the aroma of motherhood everywhere. Shirley cried out, 'Was all this in my contract?'" Sometimes mothers pray out of the frustration of it all. And sometimes in the frustration of trying to teach our children, we realize the difficulties of communication. Margaret tells of the time she gave her 3-year-old son, Drake, his first responsibility. I need to say that the names in this story have been changed to protect the innocent. Margaret told Drake to watch his baby sister, Susan, while she stepped out of the room. She had only been gone a few moments when she heard a thump, and then Susan began crying. She rushed back to find that Susan had fallen from the couch and was stretched out on the floor. Meanwhile, Drake sat there, looking oh so innocent. Margaret said, "Drake, I told you to watch her." And Drake answered, "I did." He watched her fall, and he watched her cry. He did exactly what he was told to do. Being a parent, being a mother, is not easy. Sometimes you're filled with joy and sometimes with sadness. Sometimes your children make you so proud you want to pop your buttons. And at other times you can't find enough tissues to dry up all those tears. I can understand the feelings of a mother with 3 children who was asked, "If you had to do it all over again, would you still want children?" "Oh, yes," she replied, "just not the same ones." Being a parent is not easy. It's difficult. But Mrs. Zebedee gives us a valuable example, for she asked earnestly for her sons to be part of Jesus' kingdom. We need to have that same concern for our children. What good is it if our children are successful at making money, driving fine cars, and living in good neighborhoods, but they don't know God? What does it matter if they gain the whole world but lose their souls? I hope that in the heart of every mother and father, there is a burden to go to the throne of God and to pray for your children and your grandchildren, to pray that they will seek and find a saving relationship with God through Jesus Christ. That is the place to begin. Secondly, not only did Mrs. Zebedee ask for her children to be part of the kingdom, she wanted her sons to be actively involved in the work of his kingdom. I believe it's not enough just to be saved. Churches are full of people who are content to just attend Sunday worship service. There are plenty of people willing to sit back and receive the blessings. But seldom do they get involved in doing any of the real work, the ministry of the church. But where does the spirit of service begin? It begins at home with parents setting the example and praying that their sons and daughters might be involved in the work of the kingdom. As teachers and leaders, discipling others, that they might be the ones to go out and find the lost. to see that the church continues on until Jesus comes again. Mrs. Zebedee asked that her children be more than just in his kingdom, but would be actively involved in the work of his kingdom. We all need to follow in her footsteps. And thirdly, Mrs. Zebedee had big expectations for her sons. When you are working in the kingdom, there are no higher positions than those on the right and left of the king himself. That's what she wanted for her sons. She didn't ask for her children to just be the doorkeepers. She wanted them on the right and left hand of Jesus. Now, we may consider Mrs. Zebedee brash and presumptuous, but we have to admire her boldness. Too often, people have settled for mediocrity in the church. For too long, some have been content with just barely making it through the door. For too long, they have been content to sit back and just let things happen. It is time for some of us to take our positions on the right and left hand. That is, to become leaders, molding and fashioning the outreach of our church, doing what we can to make sure the message of Christ goes out in the world. It is time to strive for more than mediocrity, but for excellence, to reach the very best there is that we can with the gift and talents and abilities that God has given us as his children. The Lord calls all of us to be his disciples and to be effective laborers in his kingdom. I started off with several stories, and one of them was the one that Irma Barback gave. And do you remember what she had God saying as he was creating a mother? I'm close to recreating something very much like myself. I suppose that's why today is special, because we recognize that a mother's love is probably the closest example we have to God's love. It is a love that goes through the valley of the shadow of death to bring life into being. It is a love that sacrifices itself over and over again, and would even dare to lay down its life for its own offspring. The story is told of Solomon Rosenberg and his family. Solomon Rosenberg and his wife, their two sons, and his parents were arrested and placed in a Nazi concentration camp during World War II. It was a labor camp. The rules were simple. As long as you do your work, you are permitted to live. When you become too weak to do your work, you will be exterminated. Rosenberg watched as his parents were marched off to their death. And he knew that next would be his youngest son, David, because David had always been a frail child. Every evening, Rosenberg would come back into the barracks after hours of labor and searched for the faces of his family. When he found them, they would huddle together, embrace one another, and thank God for another day of life. One day, Rosenberg came back and didn't see their familiar faces. He finally found his oldest son, Joshua, in a corner, huddled, weeping and praying. He said, "Josh, tell me it's not true." Joshua turned and said, "It's true, Papa. Today, David was not strong enough to do his work, so they came for him." But where is your mother?" Rosenberg asked. "Oh, Papa," he said. "When they came for David, he was afraid and he cried. Mama said, 'There's nothing to be afraid of, David.' And she took his hand and went with him." That is motherhood. Mom, this is your day. May God bless you in it. And I pray that if there is someone here who has never experienced the love of God that is so close to the love of mother, that this will be your time of decision. I pray that if you have felt that you have had to walk through the valley alone, that you will recognize that there is a hand reaching out to you saying, there is nothing to be afraid of. I'll go with you. For there is one who has already gone through the valley of the shadow for you. For Jesus has made it possible for you to have life everlasting. In a moment, we're going to be singing our commitment song. It's not a typical Mother's Day song. It doesn't turn our thoughts towards the wonders and joys of all that moms have done for us. But I think it does turn our hearts and minds towards the one who Mrs. Zebedee thought of when she wanted the best for her sons. The song is, "My Hope is Built on Nothing Less." Listen to the words. "My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name." And the chorus goes on, "Christ, the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand." So what, this is a commitment song, so what commitment am I asking of you? Well, to be honest, that really depends on you or on who you are. So, Mom, I'm asking you to make the commitment to take up Mrs. Zebedee's example. Not the "I want my kids to be put in front of the line over others" bit, but the "I want my kids to be serving God in the best way that they can." This happens to be the mom that not only points them and helps them to go there, but also shows them by example. Oh, that also goes for grandmas and dads and grandpas. There is one other place you might find yourself in this story. The James and John position. They were there too. James and John were also dressed by Jesus. And we all fall under their example, don't we? For we are all children of a mother. Our challenge is to be part of Jesus' kingdom, to be actively involved in the work of Jesus' kingdom. Commit yourself to fulfilling those big expectations that God's Spirit will help you fulfill. Make that commitment as we stand and sing, "My hope is built on nothing less." All of us can look to our moms or look to a mom that God has placed in our lives and see what it means to share God's love in the life of others. We have an example from Mrs. Zebedee of moms going beyond that to the leading and the encouraging and the striving and the desire for her children to be an active participants in the kingdom of God. That's my challenge to you. To help direct your kids and the kids that God has put into your life to see how important it is to be actively involved in God's kingdom. To first of all become part of God's kingdom by giving their life over to Christ. But then also to become actively involved. And for all of us to follow the example that she desired for her kids to move forward ourselves, to serve Him as best as we can. Let's pray. Father God, we thank You for the examples of the moms in the Bible. Even the example of the mother of James and John. The sons of thunder, we can see where they got their exuberance. But Father, may we not see the example of the pushiness, but the example of her love of wanting what was best for her kids. Father, help us strive to do what's best for our kids so they may come to know You. But Father, may we also strive so that we become the best that You want us to be in Your kingdom. Father, be with us this week. Help us to find ways to honor our mom. And help us find ways to glorify Your name. In Your Son's holy and precious name we pray. Amen.
To thy name.